So we're here for Watch Me Work, and we're working on the schedule, and we might, we're going to do this week, obviously, we're here, and we're going to do next week, and then we might take a hiatus for summer. We're coming back in the fall, just because I think a lot of people are away, and I know you guys are here. But we'll see. We'll have another conference. But next week might well be the last week for a little while before we come back in the fall, organizing around rehearsal and things like that. But anyway, here we are doing this play, which is also a free writing class, and we're going to do the dialogue second, and the work and the action part first. Let me say that again. We're going to do the action part first and the dialogue second, and the action part is going to be 45 minutes of us working, and then the dialogue is going to be talking where you guys ask me questions about your creative process. So the Watch Me Work means you. But if you are out there in the interwebs and you want to tweet us a question, Patty will tell us how to do that.
You can tweet your questions to at Watch Me Work SLP with the hashtag new play.
Watch Me Work at no.
At Watch Me Work.
At Watch Me Work SLP hashtag new play. I know it's always the same every week. And I haven't yet been able to remember. It was a different thing before. So I want to say
at Watch Me Work SLP with the hashtag new play.
Excellent. All right. So we're going to work for 45 minutes, and we're going to set our timers. Today I might be writing longhand. How exciting.
How long is it? 45?
Oh, well, let's do 42.
42.
What do you think?
I think so.
42, that's a good window.
Change
the level a little bit. Keep people on their toes. Here we go. Great.
I was charging my battery.
Oh. Yes. I see.
And I didn't want to interfere with the filming.
Oh, I see. Why?
So that was the action part of the show. She didn't notice. We were all working hard.
Been working on almost a year.
Right.
I have no names for them. And I tried to play with it as far as like maybe it could work without them having names. Maybe right. They're just nouns. But then it goes into a whole kind of experimental kind of thing. And I think they need names. But I feel like names are so heavy. You know, they can be who you are, how people view you and perception and all that. So
what about you heard what she said, what about names? And I mean, there are plenty of wonderful plays that just name their characters, you know, he, she, it, you know, one and two and five and all that kind of stuff. There are plenty of wonderful plays that do that, which I'm sure you're aware of. But it sounds like from your question that you're, because you said, well, names are so heavy, and then that's how the people will be identified. By their names and it means something, right? Is that what you said?
Yes.
I'm paraphrasing, but yeah. So, I mean, if I had said that to you, it sounds like I'm concerned about making a decision about who they are. Are you, you know what I'm saying? I mean,
I think so. I think because the play is pretty much written, they just haven't been named, and so. Yeah, you know, I pretty much know who my characters are. They know each other well, the stories, the plot, and all of that. They just, I guess they don't have a label.
Right. Well, one and two is a label, as you know, because you said that it veers into that experimental kind of thing.
Yes.
So, okay. So, what might their names be?
You want some ideas?
Yeah.
Well, for one of them, I was thinking something either along the lines of like Ashley or Sydney or something okay. with the shh.
Okay, a shh and a Y.
Or yeah.
Okay, Ashley or Sydney. And what is the other person or who are the other ones?
The other one, the father figure. Like Keith or Kenneth, but I don't know again if that, you know how sometimes the name kind of just settles in and sinks in, and these are just kind of like, I guess if I had to, maybe one
so
of these.
Ashley and Keith, Sydney and Kenneth.
That's the best I got.
That's fine.
Okay.
Why don't you try that? Right? And see how it feels. You know, Ashley and Kenneth or Keith and Sydney. That'll work.
It'll work.
Yeah, I mean, you have kids, Crystal. You told me.
Mm-hmm.
You named them, didn't you?
Yes, but I had that pre-planned.
Oh, I'm sorry. You had a pre-planned. Like 100 years ago, you were like, I'm going to name them.
At least one of them.
Okay.
You know, one of them I did.
Okay, so that's okay. And have you noticed that they kind of like, wow, they really fit their name?
Yes.
Even though I thought about it before I thought about them specifically.
Yes.
It's great, isn't it? They kind of grew into it, or it was just divine and it kind of worked out. Amazing. Same thing with your writing. Make a decision. It'll be okay. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you got some good names. Ashley, Sydney, Kenneth, Keith, whatever. You know,
yeah.
Those are great names. Go with one of those. And if you don't like them, you can change them. But I think that sounds good to me.
How long do you wait before you change them? How long in the process as far as when you're trying to put it up or pitch it before you can have to have it steady, stable?
Yeah, no, you can publish the play until you publish it. You know, you can change their names. I mean, they can even change their names halfway through the play. I mean, I do that all the time. My characters, you know, Booth becomes Three Card. You know, Hero becomes Ulysses. They change their names all the time. People like the Chino. Now I'm going to be so-and-so. Maybe they're changing the name. Maybe Sydney becomes Axel. And maybe Keith becomes Kenneth. Maybe they change their names halfway through. You can do that too.
Yes.
Yeah.
No? Yeah.
Okay. Well, good. We'll be solid.
So,
I'm so glad you came and asked that question.
Me too.
It's a great question. Yeah. Anybody else? We're on a roll, yes?
I have a story running through my mind that I thought would be a play.
Yes.
Someone, a relative of mine, who had an interesting life.
Yes.
And difficulties and changes in it.
Yes.
And every now and then I start to write it.
I'm just repeating, that's all I heard.
Can you switch back to...
You can do whatever you want. It's amazing.
well.
That's a free country so far. You know, right?
All right. Yeah, so you can, yeah, you can do whatever you want. A narrator's good. A lot of great places have narrators, like the Glass Menagerie. Right? That's a narrator. Or not a narrator, but you know what I'm talking about. Tom was like, yo, you know, there's no family. Not in those words. Anybody else have this around the world? This is exciting. But we can't stop next week. We have to continue. Maybe we'll stop in August. That's my idea. Maybe we'll go through the summer and talk about it. But you guys gotta come. I mean, I get my work done either way, but it's nicer to have, you know, people.
We'll be here.
So maybe we'll stop in August.
That would be so much better.
Christy, Julie. No, Christy. Oh, Christy. Julie, Christy. No, Christy.
Christy.
Yes.
Hi. I have a question about stage direction.
Yes.
Just what are your thoughts? I mean, I can, I like it when I read Far Away, you totally read Far Away.
Oh, great, great. Carol Churchill's great play, yes.
Some plays are just so sparse, and there's nothing left, it's just dialogue.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and some plays have more, I think I could get really heavy-handed with it myself, because I know how I see it. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that. Like, how much to leave to the actors and directors to figure it out, ultimately.
I would say anything that's necessary for the, you know, the success of the play, you know, put it in there. Don't be coy. And, oh, I'm not going to tell them that there's a big boulder in the middle of the stage. You know what I'm saying? You know. But it's a kind of a, it is a stylistic thing. Like, in the, again, Glass Menagerie. At Rise, we see blah, 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 you know, page or two, you know. That's a, I mean, that's kind of maybe not the fashion these days for writers. But there are still writers who write lots and lots of stage directions. And lots of those parenthetical thingies that tell the people how to say their lines. You know, jovially. You know, way too concerned. You know, like, I mean, it's a style thing. I tend not to do that. But, you know, a lot of really great writers do that. I would say give, you know, the bullet, the essence of what you're seeing. You know what I mean? A bare stage, or a stage with a big pyramid in the center of the stage. A slave
at the last brick.
God, I need a vacation. But, you know, does that help?
Yeah.
And if you need more, add more. And if you feel like I have too much, take it, pick some more.
I think you always take it out, you know, if it's.
Yeah,
it's too much, but I'm wondering if that's on it. And then I have another question, if I'll let someone else ask you.
Same here. No? How are you doing, Karen?
I'm great. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Is it okay?
Yeah. You're here.
I'm here, absolutely.
Yeah. He's dating my ex.
Huh?
Oh, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
I've been dating her ex for a while. It's a weird thing. Very bizarre.
It's a joke that started when we sat down. We started our own show.
Is it true?
It's not true, but we made it up today.
Oh, I love that.
What you going to say? You got to stand by it.
No, we need to get together and write it.
There you go.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, that's another project.
There you go.
I think it's the same.
What happens when you show up?
Yeah.
A whole bunch of wonderful things happen.
Are we filming the Beyonce scene in the elevator?
Are we filming the Beyonce scene in the elevator?
Okay.
Ooh, gosh, I had you know, it just, yeah,
it went
faded.
Away.
Huh? I think it faded, right? I think they put out some videos to make us think that everything's all right. Right? And our attention just turned to other things.
Oh, yeah.
Funny how that happens.
Yeah. It's kind of a question and a thank you. About 2 weeks ago, you said, well, why don't you take index cards and do it like, you know, and I did.
Wow.
And I don't, and I found maybe a different way to go.
Wow.
And it was really, I don't like go, ooh, I hate what I wrote now. It's just sort of like, it's a process, isn't it? I mean, it's sort of so interesting to, it just is a process,
Wow.
And it made me realize you know, all your own shit. You impose on your process instead of just letting the process do its thing. And so I started to work on it again, which is really interesting. Thank you.
That's
so thank
great.
You.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm so glad.
It
that's
really
so glad.
Helped to outline, like, you know.
Right. Yeah, because sometimes you can get bogged down, like you said, sometimes we can get bogged down by all the shit that's on our shit.
Yeah.
Because shit has a lot of shit on
it. Yes, it does.
Our shit, you know, there comes out of us, it's like, oh, shit. Yeah, it can be very debilitating and depressing and overwhelming and all those words.
It stops you.
Yes. It stops you. And somehow, that's the trick. What do you do when you don't know what you're doing? And what do you do when you feel like not doing it? But you know you have to do it.
You know, Dante, you know, I mean, about the sixth ring, I'm sure he said, oh, I'm doing something.
Right, exactly. Yeah, he just kept going.
Yeah.
And to address Crystal's question, Most Def changed his name from Dante to Most to Yasin Bey.
What?
I'm just keeping you up to date.
Interesting.
Yeah, he did. When you started out as Dante.
Muhammad Ali.
Changed. Exactly.
You
from
know.
Cassius Clay.
Cassius Clay.
So see, you know. But sometimes when you're in the dark wood, you know, Paul and Saul, or Saul and Paul, riding his horse from somewhere. I forget where. Christy, another question?
Yes. The beginning of my play is it's two friends that were very good friends and haven't seen each other for 10 years.
Right.
And that's just the story. And so I'm always struggling with, you know, if I saw you, I haven't seen you in 10 years, and sit down and talk, right, you know. But, you know, it's very tedious and boring for an audience. I think you led through all that stuff, catching up.
Okay.
And so I'm trying to figure out how to not do that, you know, how to move through the catch up
thing. Right. So Christy has two characters in her, at the beginning of her play, they're really good friends, but they haven't seen each other for 10 years. And how to move through, how to, you know, leap over all that. So what's the context of their meeting?
It was a surprise. She happened to see her mom on a plane. She didn't know how to find her for 10 years, and it was like a coincidence, and so she's just kind of there surprisingly. She wasn't expecting her, she's there. It's fortuitous, it's good, but it's inconvenient for the character who she's visiting.
Right.
It's a
surprise. She rings the bell. And
no, I mean, she got a call, so she knows she's coming.
She's got a but call from the train station or from the airport?
From the airport.
Hi, I'm here, I'm in town. I'm coming.
I found you with a lover's prize.
And she picked up the phone from this person saying, come. I mean, what I'm trying to get you think of is context, because context sort of cuts through a lot of that stuff.
Yeah,
she picked up the phone.
Yeah. And she said, you know,
come on over.
Come on by.
Come on by. Right. Why haven't they kept in touch with Chambers?
Because their lives, they're just went in totally different directions. Their lives completely diverged. And there was a big blowout that happened. Back 10 years ago, there was you know, incident,
right.
And they went on their way, but they were very, very good friends before that incident.
Yeah, yeah. So you have to really ground it in context. You know what I mean? Because if there was a blowout 10 years ago, you know, and you happen to be in the airport and call, so there's a lot of there's phone conversation that happens on the phone that we don't see. That's about that blah blah blah. There's were they Facebook friends or?
No. For the character who's arriving, it's like a huge, amazing miracle that she found her. That she
right.
That makes her mom.
Right. But it's just, you have to ground it in the reality of the conflict. Do you know what I'm talking about? Like, if we hadn't seen each other in 10 years and I was like, Maddie, the last time we saw each other?
Right.
There's not going to be a lot of that blah, 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 blah.
Right. Right.
It's not. And you come, call me from the airport, and hey, I'm in town! All right, well, great. I'll meet you at Starbucks.
Well, you don't know that what you did offended me. Like, I just took off. So you offended me.
Yeah, you figure it did because you couldn't separate. Just get specific about the, get specific about what happened, how they felt about it. Get specific about the backstory that you'll know how to cut through. Because the chit chat is very specific. When people who do that chit chat are, establishing something or re-establishing something. You just have to get very specific about what was there, and then you'll know how they encounter each other. You see me without like a specific records. Don't have the time with it. Does that make sense? Really grounded in the specifics of what happened, what they felt about it. Who knew what, when, how long is she in town for, oh, is it a layover, a twin flight, is she going to Europe, or she's got to go back to JFK in an hour, does she just want to see her? And think about it, you get a phone call, you answer the phone, that's already like, who does that? I don't know, your phone rings, the number comes up, you know the person. It's her. So you gotta call that. That sounds very exciting. Yeah. But there are 100 ways to not invite someone over and get off the phone. So all those things didn't happen. And here she is at her doorstep. So that cuts through a lot of the chit chat. Plus there's from the airport to the apartment, there's a lot of talking on the phone, maybe so. This chit chat only happens like, oh hi, oh my god, Carol, I haven't seen you in 3 years, oh my god, how are you doing? But if there's shit going down, it's just so different. I'm not. And I do it all the time. And we all do. I'm like, ooh, oh god, I'm so glad they didn't see me. I'm hiding behind my hair.
I do that in this building.
Oh, right. You can do it all the time. Why am I sitting here? Keep talking. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I need this left. So I was thinking about the class. And what it really means to me to come every day and at once a week and here. And why it's so special. And I was walking down the street and I saw this this quote on a church, and I thought you should
say. Oh, this is beautiful. So it's from the Community Church of New York, and it says, at times our own light goes out, and is rekindled by a spark from another. At times, our own light goes out and is rekindled by a spark from another. Albert Schweitzer. That's beautiful. That is exactly it. Also, it's almost, spark is almost my name. Almost. It's funny, I talked to someone once on the phone, and I said, my last name is Parks. And they said, funny, you don't sound Korean.
No.
Anyway, that's beautiful. That's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is. And we do it for each other. And even with people online, you can do this virtually. We goose each other. Yeah. Anybody else? You good? You all good? We're going home? Yeah.
That's a good, like, last song.
Okay,
for my shift.
Okay, thanks for coming.